Djibouti, area. So obviously they are trying to get some kind of a control over the Indian Ocean region and presence in that area, which is really not in much in the interest of India. It is immediately, I don't think we are in a position to be able to take on Indian Navy in that particular area. But the way they are progressing, the way they are spending money, and they have full attention towards modernization of their armed forces, in very near future, maybe 5 years' time, they would be in a position to be able to undertake blue water operations. Recently, a report has come out of the US Pentagon on the Chinese ambitions in the world affairs and how they are acting and how they are doing with their armed forces. So that gives you a very clear idea about what lies ahead as far as they are concerned. On all these issues, and especially the VAT road, Mr. Ravi is very kind to have agreed to deliver a talk, and we made a request, he very readily agreed to it, and we are grateful to him for that. And I think without taking any much more time, I'll request him to and deliver his talk. Thank you so much to Mr. Ravi. Thank you.
Thank you, General Veej, for this honor and opportunity given to me to interact with this distinguished audience. I am conscious of the richness of experience, knowledge, and wisdom present in this hall. I can see some seniors who are far more experienced and have greater insight in issues than I do have. And I also see some young scholars who have appetite for deep dive. So I'm looking forward to taking something from here, because essentially what we do at the JIC, Joint Intelligence Committee, is we prepare assessment on issues of national security for the benefit of National Security Council, which comprises the Prime Minister, assisted by the four ministers, Raksha Mantri, Grih Mantri, Vitt Mantri, Videsh Mantri, assisted by the National Security Advisor. Today, we'll be talking about the Belt Road Initiative of China and what it means for us. I think I may not be wide off the mark if I say that this is one issue which has been talked about most in the strategic community in the recent times. Within this country, even externally, people have interpreted it differently. Is it economic initiative? Is it a strategic? Is it perhaps the mix of the two? Is it that the China believes that its time has come and it should realize its dream of being the Middle Kingdom? A lot of interpretations, a lot of writings have come upon this subject. What here I'm going to share with you is, how do we look at it? What is our assessment of Belt and Road Initiative of China? And what it means for us? We look at the BRI as China's strategy for its comprehensive growth. And by comprehensive growth, we mean economic, military, and political. We all know that this was launched in some, in a very, very unrefined way, perhaps, in two installments by Chinese president in September and October 2013, when he launched Silk Road Economic Belt and Maritime Silk Route. Later they refined it, they called it One Belt, One Road, further refined it, they called it Belt Road Initiative, and nowadays they would like to call it Belt Road Initiative for International Cooperation. Now, was it launched in 2013? Publicly, yes. But did it begin then? Because when it comes to China, we all know that unlike many other countries, including ours, where we first articulate a policy and then we go for its implementation. Chinese way is different. They don't publicly articulate their policy, especially their important policies. They take a decision, try to implement it, test it, and at appropriate time they make it public. Take the case. 2015, Chinese published the document publicly stating that now they would have a maritime orientation of their PLA. And there was a lot of debate all over that, well, now China is going to be a great naval power. How the equation within the PLA, within the army, within the navy and all that will emerge, because after all PLA army has been the preeminent wing of the PLA, and now with the preeminence shifting to the navy, there will be internal dynamic, internal tensions and all. But look at the ground situation. China had begun building the maritime infrastructure assets across the world since the beginning of this century. 2005, of the top 50 container ports in the world, 10% of it were either owned by China or Chinese were heavily invested in them. 5 years later, in 2010, from 10% it grew to 20%. And by 2015, they had almost 70% of the top 50 container ports were either owned by China or Chinese were heavily invested in them. 2016, they launched 19 naval warships. Between 2013 and 16, they launched 5 replenishment ships. Their policy became public in 2015, but the work had begun long, long back, because after all, you can't do all these things over time, over here. They had built this, they had begun building the required industrial complex and reaching out well before they announced this, their policy. Take the case of CPEC. We have all been talking about it since May 2013 when Chinese announced it, the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor. But did it really begin then? It began in 2001, when in the nondescript port of Gwadar, the 2001 when the Chinese Premier visited Pakistan and this particular piece of coast was given to a Chinese company to develop it, and they developed it. Phase one of Gwadar completed by 2006. As usual, they marketed well. Pakistanis thought that perhaps it would be a a bonanza for them, a commercial bonanza initially, or maybe they also, of course, they always thought that Chinese presence would always be to their advantage, you know, strategic advantage. But given them that so much of loan, burden Pakistan with the loan, having completed the job by 2006, they left. And Singapore Port Authority, PSA, they stepped in. They were also this, the idea of this Gwadar port being a commercially lucrative port, they also bought in, perhaps in their calculation, they thought that it might work, so they have to develop and operationalize it and keep it running. Soon they realized it was unsustainable. And by 2013, somehow they reeled out. And then the China Port Holding Company, I mean, the overseas port holding company took over. And it built it further and built it into a Chinese asset. 2013, to make it, perhaps to give it some more aspect to it, and also add economic aspect by building the connectivity and expanding it in a much broader way. Part of it, even perhaps a glimpse of it, you might have got what it was leaked in Dawn. They started talking, but the foundation was laid long before. Hamban Tota started in 2008. Chofu in Myanmar 2009. Chittagong, they tried when they were not getting it well. A little south at Sonadia, they started working in 2010. By 2012, Djibouti, they were already well established. Of course, 2016, they made it very clear that they would be building it, their military base with about 10,000 soldiers. So China makes its policy public much later. It begins working on it way before. Now the question is, if the strategy, if this entire initiative of reaching out is essentially a Chinese strategy for its comprehensive growth, then what was the need for launching this so-called One Belt, One Road or BRI in 2013? Yes. By 2010, they realized that their economy was thus the double-digit growth. That period was not sustainable. They could see it. And that proved right. It went through a stagnation and then eventual slide down to a single digit and further down. Now, at that point of time, they needed to create market, to create external demand, to absorb its industrial overcapacity, idle capital. And how do you create a market? How do you create a demand? The marketing strategy. And as a marketing strategy, they came up with the One Belt, One Road, Silk Road, all these things, and finally One Belt Road Initiative is a brand. It's a brand to aggressively push its agenda for comprehensive growth. They use all kinds of language for it. It's not a solo, it's a symphony. They, all choices, expressions they use. But essentially, BRI, which they made it public in 2013, they created a brand for the projects they were already doing, the policy, which is a strategy which they were already pursuing, to give it an aggressive push, because they realized that slowdown in the economy will create such a huge backlash, it will be difficult for them to sustain. It will create huge problem, unemployment, public unrest. So they had to create more, and so they created through the marketing strategy, they created the brand and they started pushing it ahead. And what happened in the middle last month when they created, when they had the event, it was nothing but an event to promote the brand. Many people have written about India's non-participation because we chose to stay out. Well, everyone is free to have one's view. But we did it for certain reasons, which I will come down later. Now, stripped of its, you know, panache, it's all the glitter, the marketing glitter that goes with aggressive advertisement. What is there? It is essential. How does China pursue its strategy for comprehensive growth? Let us look at it. First and foremost, China, we know that China as a state is the principal economic actor in China and abroad. And as a state actor, it abuses the free market economic order. Because the underlying principle of a free market economy, as enunciated by Adam Smith, is, as we all know, that if the economic actors are free to pursue their incentive, their interest, that is profit, then the invisible hand of the market will ensure the best possible return for all. That is the axiom on which the free market economy is based. So an economic actor pursues its interest, which is profit, economic profit. But when a state becomes a predominant economic actor, state's motives or interests are not merely economic profit. It has huge strategic interest. And in pursuit of that strategic interest, it doesn't mind absorbing huge losses here and there, wherever. It believes that the huge economic loss is amply compensated in strategic gains. It will do that. But that's not the case with a classical economic actor. So China's being part of this free market economy order, member of WTO, we also were a very enthusiastic supporter of China being inducted into it, has been abusing this free market order. What it does, it creates artificial demand, because looking for creating demands market for its product. So it creates artificial demand, a demand which may not be either the genuine or sustainable demand, or demand which is in the order of priority. A country needs a lot of things. Now when Pakistan, two existing ports, Qasim and Karachi, were not operating even at their 50% capacity, did it make any rational economic sense to have a third port? But it created a demand and it got into it. Sri Lanka, existing ports, again the same case, were not working to their optimum capacity, but Hambantota, a demand, they created a demand and started got into it. And these countries, they bought into this. So it creates artificial demand and steps into fulfilling those demands. And when it does a step in, it steps in on its own term. Means identification of the project, feasibility study of the project, cost determination of the project, and execution of it. All done by the Chinese, by and large. And when they execute the project, it's their company which will do the work, of course. Their capital. Capital includes fund, money, as well as materials. And to a significant extent, their labor. How does the host country benefit? Because when you, and all these are coming by way of loan, it's not coming gratis, it's not coming as something which is at a very highly concessional, unless if the project is strategic. When I need a project, I need a road to be built, and I approach a financial institution. We do the feasibility study and then work out what could be the cost of it. And then the financial institutions agree to give the loan. I go for a larger bidding so that you get the best value out of your money. By way of open this international tendering, and at least enlarging the canvas, a spectrum of the bidders. China doesn't allow that. And reluctantly it agrees to a limited tender. Limited tender means there will be a number of Chinese companies, among them you choose one. This is how China operates. And then when it gives the money, invariably it is giving now in Chinese currency yuan. Well, we all know that yuan is now in SDR. But there are not many takers for it. So when you take loan in Chinese yuan, how do you repay it? For repaying, you need yuan. For that, you need to have a surplus trade. All the countries, I think maybe, I don't know whether there is an exception, but they all have huge trade deficit with China. Means they import far more than they export. Take the case of Bangladesh. Hamara case apply hai kuch hai. We have about, in 2016, we have about $47.7 billion deficit. Bangladesh imports about $9 billion, exports about $700 million. That's the case with by and large. So when you take loan in yuan, you don't have yuan, you have to pay back in dollar. And who fixes the exchange rate between yuan and dollar? It's the China. Now you run the risk, exchange rate risk, which you are paying. Now, it's a very, very convoluted and very one-sided way of doing business. This is how it does business. This is how it has been pursuing its growth strategy, which it has renamed or branded as Belt Road Initiative. It has expanded the basket. It called it connectivity. It has gone beyond that. It also builds special economic zones and so many other things. Now, if this is what BRI is, if it is a Chinese policy of comprehensive growth which has been pursuing for last at least 16 years, which it has rebranded to give aggressive push at as BRI, then what it means for us? Of course, the first and foremost which we have emphatically articulated is our concern over CPEC, China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, and issue of sovereignty. That's a point which has been well emphasized. Beyond that, what? Look, it is aggressively pushing itself in our neighborhood. Nepal, Bangladesh, Burma, Sri Lanka, Maldives. I'm not talking about Pakistan. And when it pushes inside these countries, how does it impact us? Our close neighbors. It creates economic, political and security, that is the military dependencies of these countries over China. When they take, these countries take low in infrastructure building, and we all know that infrastructure by itself rarely pays its own cost. It is a necessary but not sufficient condition for growth. You build a road doesn't pay off its cost. You build a bridge doesn't pay off its cost. It creates, it creates an ecosystem. It is expected to stimulate activities which will lead to growth. But when these countries, they take loan in these infrastructure, expensive loans, and not able to repay, these countries will get into what you call debt trap. A glaring example, as we see, is in Hambantota, Sri Lanka. A non-productive, useless, not required port. They created a demand, sold the demand. Of course, the country has to buy it. But the regime was such, the environment was such that they were able to sell it to the country. Then the regime. Sri Lankan regime. That look, this port is sitting right close to the east-west sea lines of communication. What a commercial bonanza it will have. Ships will be coming for servicing, OTR, all this. When it was built, they realized that hardly a ship visits. They built airport, Matala Airport, hardly one flight a day. These are not sustainable. So, when China is not, then they ask for the loan, the yes return. And when Sri Lanka is not able to return the loan, okay, in that case, do one thing. What you do? No, we first give the loan. And they strike a deal, okay, fine. Let the port be ours by having the majority stake. Now, they are expected to have about 80% of the equity in Hambantota. So virtually, the port becomes a Chinese port. Similar is the case, is going to be the case even with Gwalior. But having even taken over the port, they say is not enough. Because we got the port, we go, okay, it's equity we have taken, we have 80% of the loan, which we were not able to pay up the 80% of the loan, we have taken ourselves, absorbed it. But it's a dead investment. You need to give us access to some more land where we can build and do some more activity, commercial activity, which in turn will generate revenue, revenue for you and revenue for us. Otherwise, it's for us, it's a dead investment. And then they are now struggling, now haggling for a large piece of land, doing all kinds of agreement negotiations going on. So you find countries' ability to take an independent decision is usually compromised. Now take the case of Bangladesh. One of the major projects where Chinese are in is Padma Multipurpose Bridge Project. It's about 3 billion plus. There has been cost escalation. Now, how Bangladesh is going to handle it is now in a fix. A number of infrastructure projects, that's that part. China also builds a CJET, a special economic zone it builds in any of our neighbors. What does it mean to us? When an SEZ is built in Bangladesh, what it will do? China will shift its manufacturing, some of its relocate, some of its manufacturing industries here, especially the sunset industries, because China, the labor cost is going up. Goods are not as competitive because of the rising cost of input. China doesn't have that preferential access to the market which least developed countries or the certain countries who qualify under WTO, they don't. So, China starts putting up industries in SEZ in Bangladesh. Well, they do it in, let's say, garment, R&D, ready-made garments and textile. Now, they produce the goods there in this SEZ. But Bangladesh market doesn't have the capacity to absorb it, not even a fraction of it. So those manufactured goods come over to us. And under WTO, you cannot have a discrimination regime, you can't stop. Because then the goods are produced in Bangladesh. Chinese are producing goods in Bangladesh, and those goods are accessing your market. There are certain sectors, especially textile and RMG. Bangladesh and India, we are competing with each other. India also has about 40 million plus of textile and RMG export. Now, the cheaper goods getting into Indian markets, which you cannot stop. Also the European, external market, let us say European market. Bangladesh has GSP, what they call it, generalized system preference, under which they have preferential access to European market. India, we don't have. So as such, we have a disadvantage in competing with Bangladesh. Now, with the Chinese manufacturing these goods in Bangladesh, it not only it will flood our market, it affects our industries, but it also causes heavy export erosion. A lot of other goods, consumer goods, shoe, other usables, consumables. So many things can be manufactured, and that impacts, that hurts our economic interest. Now, they have signed an MOU with Nepal to build one SEZ right at our border at Dhamak. Now, if they set up an SEZ at Dhamak and set up their manufacturing industries, where do the goods go? Nepal market doesn't have the capacity to absorb even a fraction of it. Eventually it has to come. What eventually? It has to come to Indian market. And it is not illicit. It is illicit apart. It will come informally because we are under obligation. If the goods manufactured in Nepal, we cannot put so many restrictions on it coming to us. It is going to heavily damage our industries, our economy. China, we have been talking, because Mostly we have been confined to a strategic aspect about military dimension of it. That's what I believe there are a lot many experts here who are far more experienced than I am. I'm highlighting how it hurts even the economy. This is very, very, very crucial. So when China under BRI gets into our neighborhood, gets into all these activities, which hurts our economic interest, which erodes our political influence vis-à-vis those countries, and also undermines our security. So what do we do? What are the options that we have? There have been a lot of writings, a lot of people, experts have given opinion that we should not have stayed away from the show. Because 29 heads of the government and heads of state, they participated. More than 60 countries, they participated. Countries like United States of America, they also participated, who have been critical of the China. Japan also, which has been okay, they also have participated. Why not you? You know, when they have created this kind of an advertisement, this kind of an aggressive publicity boom, all these countries look for a business opportunities here. Perhaps, maybe, as we know, I'm not going into the details of various stated arms of OBO, especially the six areas where they have the China, Mongolia, the Russia corridor, China, Central West, I mean Central Asia, West and Central Asia, West Asia corridor, BCIF, and then on the eastern, on the sort of Indochina. I'm not going into the specific, these are all immaterial. We are coming to the basic of BRI, what it means to us. Whether it does project here or there, so far it's good for China. Is it good for us? It's not that we are sinophobic. Yes, no. We like to engage with China, but with our eyes open. If we join this bandwagon, then that means we endorse it. We say we approve it. Howsoever subdued our representation might be, we might end up just sulking that look, China is causing harm. But well, because so many countries went, everyone went, so we also had to send it. We also participate, we also endorse it. Now, when you endorse a project which, or an initiative or a strategy which hurts your interest so heavily, then your neighbors and your friends, if they let Chinese get into these countries and work, how do you tell them that this is not good? You should reconsider. Well, in any case, every country will go by its own interest. And China will push it, those countries, if they require it, they will take it, if they don't, they won't. But if we endorse it, it makes it far easier for all to go along. Now, once we have taken a decision that no, BRI as a brand is not acceptable to us. As an individual product, yes, we are open to explore it. But as a brand, no, we don't accept it. Now, our neighbors and friends, with our this categorically stated position, certainly would not altogether ignore India's sensitivities. I don't say that this is going to harm the Belt Road initiative of China or do them any kind of significant damage. We need to protect our own interest. And as an interest especially in our neighborhood. We cannot be seen as a chorus boy to a Chinese orchestra when we know that it hurts our interest. So better reject the brand rather than remaining ambivalent. So this was a very conscious decision, because by going and joining, it hurts our interest, it would damage our interest very badly. And we couldn't afford it. So we made it clear. Now, since we have stated and made our position clear, then where do we go from there? Yes, we need to build our own connectivity. First and foremost, our own internal within the country. Because before China began reaching out to the rest of the world, they created their own internal connectivity. All over, we all know how much, even in the far-flung areas, what kind of infrastructure they have built. So having built the connectivity, they reached out. Today, we are quite efficient, and we have to do that. On the land, as well as along the coast. And under various projects it's going on. Like on the land, a lot of course, the work we are aware of, how much the Surface Transport Ministry is doing it. And along the coast, under Project Sagarmala, we are building a chain of the string of ports. That's not enough. At the end, you know, side by side, we also have to build the regional connectivity. In the country, after all, your neighbors will need infrastructure. Can we do something to help them? Our own assessment is that if we get into it, we can do the project in less than 50% of the cost which China charges. Of course, the experts say that no, it's far less, it will be doing it in about 30%, but with the margin. Take the case of North Chennai power plant. How the Chinese they do it? It's a 900 megawatt project in Sri Lanka. They pegged it at 1.25 or so billion dollars. Actual cost is less than 9. Actual, not that the actual cost it came, but in the deal, though the stated cost is 1.25 billion, the cost is 900 million. The 30% of it has gone as kickback. And when Sri Lanka is not able to repay and say that you take equity, then the Chinese say equity is not for 1.25 billion. Because they know that the project is not worth 1.25 billion, it is only 900 million. Now they are in trouble. Sri Lankans are in trouble. Now Chinese way of doing business is very, very mercantile. They go straight for kill. Now we believe that we can do the project in a much, on a much lesser cost, and we can help them get what they want. If necessary, of course, with the help of, we don't have that much of capital. Maybe we can do it in collaboration with our friends. Recently, in the Africa Summit, Prime Minister talked about Asia-Africa corridor, growth corridor. Well, these are workable concepts. And we can work. So, while we take a position on it, we say that, okay, on your specific project, we are open. It's not that we say that we are hostile to you. Many people say that, many of the experts wrote that India, by staying away, is incurring the wrath of mighty China. It is a hostile act. Some of our experts also go to the extent of saying that this is a pet project of Chinese President Xi. So much used we are to individuals and leaders. Xi might have articulated it. The project began 15 years back. To say that this, if you don't, then you are incurring the displeasure of the king, the Chinese king. What kind of notion we are trying to propagate? We have made our position clear, categorical. We need, and when we say that we will examine the product, there is one product on which we are engaged, BCIM. We have not said no. Recently only we held a joint meeting in Kolkata. We will see. If it is good for us, we will go for it. If it is not, fine. Maritime capability we have to build, of course, because after all, maritime both commercial as well as naval. We have the a lot of distance to cover. We have certain natural advantages. Our island chains on the east and the west, Andaman, Nicobar, Lakshadweep. We have never looked at them as our strategic asset. We are looking at them. There are many ways by which India's story will go on. Because I don't believe, and I don't think any of us in our right mind should believe that India can be isolated or alienated in the globe. In the community of nations, because given our economic and political heft, no country can afford to go to that extent. All that we need to do is we are not hostile to anyone. Like anyone else, we like to protect our interest, and we should take a clinical look at any initiative. If it is good for us, we'll go for it. Whether it comes from China, it comes from Japan. But we will not dissuade simply because there is a so-called emerging superpower is trying to intimidate the people around. We cannot be intimidated. Well, I think broadly I have tried to make my point. I'd be very happy to benefit from your being here. Thank you, Dave.
Thank you very much. Thank you for your
comprehensive presentation. I have two brief questions. You know, one, Mr. Ravi, when you mentioned that China is investing in Bangladesh, Nepal, and let's take the case of textiles and ready-made garments, it comes to the Indian market. You know, we are not bound to take everything that comes from there. It has to meet the criteria of the rules of origin. It has to be manufactured in Bangladesh. Even if it meets that, and if it hurts our domestic industry, we can put obstacles, we can anti-dumping, countervailing, whatever it is. And also if we see, you know, if this was happening, if we look at both the structure of trade between India and Bangladesh and India and Nepal, we are exporting about $6 billion to them. And we are getting, I think, just about 500, 600 million. So I don't think that is really happening, at least so far. The other question, I think this thing that it might, you know, whatever investments are coming there, they might flood our market. I think even if it does exist, in my view, it's a little overblown. The second aspect that I, like to mention is that, China, whenever it takes up projects, I was in Central Asia, they have constructed, whether it is the oil pipeline or other things, other projects, they are completed very quickly. Now, the record of India, unfortunately so far, has been rather unimpressive. If you look at the International North-South Transport Corridor, when I was in Moscow in the late 90s, it started. And we are still sort of, you know, toiling with it. Even Chabahar, 2003. If you look on the east side, whether it is the Trilateral Highway, the Kaladan Multimodal, you know, there are so many examples. So I think one thing we will need to do if we really wish to restore credibility in the minds of our neighbors and interlocutors is really to make sure that whatever we promise, we are able to deliver it in good time. Thank you.
Sir, on your this observation, I don't think there can be any dispute over it. About the first part that you said about, yes, we are not bound if it hurts our interest, but the fact is that you have to put additional measures. You will be accused of being discriminatory if the product is something manufactured in your area, in Bangladesh. So it does put a strain on you. It's not that you can just just do it and get away just like that. Because being member of WTO, you have to take a call. There are certain obligations. And in the process of meeting those obligations, you would have to bear certain cost. Now, Chinese, when they start manufacturing goods in Bangladesh and or Nepal, they are Nepalese and Bangladeshi goods. That is where the place of origin. And how do you stop it? Very difficult. Plus international market. Yes, point well taken. But it doesn't leave you that with that sense of comfort. Yes, as far as Chinese way of doing business fast, there's no doubt we have to learn. There is a need for systemic connections. But we have certain advantages, which, of course, it doesn't offset the delay that we cause. Our projects usually come with. You mentioned about Central Asia. You are aware of how in Kyrgyzstan, the government had to go because of corruption in the Chinese deal. They had a project, they did construct a massive road, and then there was an allegation of corruption. Parliamentary committee got into it, and finally the prime minister had to resign. They set up a oil refinery, thinking that that would reduce their dependence from Russia. Because all these Central Asian countries, somewhere psychologically, they feel that they are still under the embrace or tight grip of Russia. They have some sense of nationalism they like to get. So they thought the Chinese gave them a big dream that, okay, we will set up an sort of industry, this oil refinery, and that will reduce your dependence. They built the refinery, over $400 million. It doesn't work, it's not even working at the 6% of the capacity. So Chinese doing fast is no. But what comes out of the product is also has to be factored in. We need to be conscious of our limitations. We are, and I think we have to overcome. I fully agree with you that we need to deliver. We promise, we don't deliver, and that erodes our credibility. No doubt about it.
Okay.
One question and one comment. Could you tell us a little more about the terms and conditions on which China gives credit or makes investment under OBOR or BRI initiative? One has heard that most of it is credit. Most of it, in fact, goes to the Chinese companies who tie up individual deals. So if you could let us have something about the terms and conditions. And the comment is, I entirely agree with what Mr. Ashok Sinha, my batchmate, just now said. We can do whatever breastfeeding, we can criticize the Chinese, but unless we deliver, none of our friends or neighbors will really heed our concerns, and we lose credibility. I have been at the receiving end, being the ambassador to Iran for 4 years. And what he mentioned about INSTC and Chabahar, I don't want to take your time, this audience's time, to go into details. But unless you improve delivery, you mentioned something about the ports being built by the Chinese all over the world. There was a proposal in Shipping Ministry to set up a global fund to help Indian companies build ports, because these companies now have presence across the globe in Africa and Far East and so on. The proposal never took off. It was not because we don't have money, but you know, there are always questions which can be raised. And the last comment, what you mentioned, I agree. If the Chinese first do their homework and then announce, we make the announcement and then forget to follow up.
So on this terms and condition on which Chinese keep low, of course it varies. Chinese are pretty flexible about it. But I will give you certain illustration by which perhaps it will give us some insight, which you might be aware of. Take the case of CPEC-related projects in Pakistan. There are three sets of projects as far as China is concerned, Chinese interests are concerned. One is a water port, which is China is fully invested. So there is an element of grant, and whatever loan is there, the loan is at soft loan, about 2%, 2.5%. Another is fiber optical cable, OFC, optical fiber cables. This virtually is coming as like a grant, not big amount, but it's coming as a grant. When it comes to power project, which is about 72-73% of the CPEC project is for power, the interest, the loan is mercantile interest. They charge about 6%, which is higher than the LIBOR. Plus, if a Chinese non-state enterprise is doing the work, they are under obligation to get it insured with the Chinese insurance sinecure. That additional premium comes. As a result, you will find that many of the projects, while the water is moving at very fast, optical fiber cable is going on very well, but other sectors which are not of Chinese priority, like main trunk road, yes, they are doing it. Main road that, what is popularly called the Eastern Alignment, it's a loan, but loan is coming. Others, they have been pretty conservative because they don't like to sink their money, they make a big announcement, but when it comes to the actual investment, they are very, very careful of the return. Wherever it is strategic, they are generous, they move fast. That is why the border is going tick on city, pretty fast. Power projects, way behind. They had said by 2017 they would generate 10,400 megawatt. They have signed agreement, finally agreement. What you call is financial closure is for less than 3,000. They're pretty conservative. So when China giving loan, there's no uniform pattern by which they fall. Pattern which they fall, they go it. The case by case, depending on how secure is their money and the return, how high is the return. That's the norm which they follow. About the rest of other part that you made the observation, yes, I don't think we can keep talking with the fact is that yes, we have systemic issues and we have to transform.
Okay, there was such a...
I heard the Chinese ambassador Louis speaking on in the IDSA and making a very strong case on the BRI. That there is a possibility to separate sovereignty issues with bilateral relations. And he gave all sorts of things like changing the name and why can't we do business we have done earlier in the old Silk Route, and giving number of points of formulas that we can have the FTA agreement, we can have this, that, and the other in good neighborly relation, treaties and so on, and also deliver on the border issue. We know very well that all these are non-viable. But my mind goes to our joining the Asian Development Bank. When we joined the Asian Development Bank, we made a clause that any project which is held or funded in a disputed land will have the agreement and okay of the disputants. Now our main concern, as you rightly brought out, is why we are not joining this, is our sovereignty issue. We also know very well that this 46 billion investment which has gone through in the CPAC is unlikely to be rolled back. It is a reality of life. So besides saying no, we are not joining, is there any other thought, like the thought of the ADB putting in place certain safeguards that in any project in the disputed land will have agreement like this? Can we do some thinking on the second portion? One portion is clear, yes, we are not joining. Yes, it is passing through POK, passing through Pakistan. Fine. But can we safeguard our interest in some other fashion? Thank you.
Thank you, sir. We know that for this Belt Road Initiative, there is not one Chinese institution which is doing all this. They are all spread over the ministries. It's still an amorphous tag, I should say, because the strategy is the same. They are trying to somehow make this tag marketable. When China does the business with its own capital, how do you make it? How do you influence it? Well, as far as Chinese making investment in the disputed area, which is our area, what we can do beyond protesting it? Yes, there are certain measures which we can think of, but these have to be examined. It's not that it's not a studied position, but there are positions which we can take. Now, can we have a law of sanctions that if a country or an entity does a business in an area which we consider is ours or disputed, can we sanction those companies and entities so that there is some amount of deterrence on those companies, not only Chinese? We have been also hearing about so many other countries trying to join the CPEC. This can be helpful. We can explore this. We know that on the sideline of this, promotion show in the middle of May, they also signed certain MOUs for building up more and more projects in POJK, all these dams, Daman Pasha. No. China has to realize, China will continue doing it, but for you, how much cost you can raise it for them? If you can raise the cost, which makes it to a point where it makes it difficult for them to do the business, they will do it. They are very smart people. They will not just sit on the ego and say, come what may, their interest is hurt. No. Once their interest hurts, they will not do it. But can we do it? We have to explore options. Yes.
Okay. You. I'll come back to you.
Recently, two Chinese were killed by Talibanis in Pakistan. So that has exposed a very serious tension to this entire issue. So now, what are the implications in future? Is it going to become a sort of fledgling another Afghanistan? They may have to rush out like that, or maybe what are the problems?
No, I think Chinese are likely to be deterred by these the few killings. Of course, it's a concern for them. Now they are trying to downplay by saying that these two Chinese, those who have been killed, and Islamic State has claimed the responsibility for their killing. They were not. They had nothing to do with CPEC. They were Chinese missionary workers, and they were in league with some South Koreans, and they were doing proselytization work. They are trying to, but the fact is that off and on we do hear that the project-related people have been harmed, people have been killed, laborers, engineers. It is a serious concern. And to safeguard its interest, as we are aware, China insisted and Pakistan has created a special security division. One more division is in the pipeline, they are working on it. So, with Pakistani army in the driver's seat for this CPEC project, we don't see that these stray or sporadic killings are going to compel the Chinese to abandon the project. Yes, it will raise the cost for China. Eventually the cost will come on Pakistan. It will cause delay that itself will add to the cost. But it is unlikely that China will be deterred by it.
Thank you, Chair. So it's very, very interesting presentation that you made. I have two questions. One question is that, you know, you mentioned about various ports around India, like the string of birds, and one assumes that we perceive a strategic threat emanating from the location of these ports. So I'm just wondering what really is going to be our diplomatic or national strategy to liquidate these kind of threats emanating from these ports. Or whether at present we don't think that they are actually a threat, but at some stage they might present a threat, strategic threat to us. That's my first question. The second one is you talked about the BRI as a brand which we reject. Now, of course, one knows the Chinese have different funds to finance many of these projects. There's a Silk Road Fund and other places, other kind of fund that they use, and you mentioned about various ministries. Now, we are members of the Asian Infrastructure Development Bank, with the largest equity shareholder in that. We are also the vice chair, we have a CEO, we have a CEO in the BRICS Development Bank, which actually are also meant to finance infrastructure projects. Moreover, we have joined the SCO, where Pakistan also is a member. So I'm wondering what would really be our strategy, because in one case we actually bought an equity in the IEB and also BRICS Development Bank. What really is our strategy when we reject the Belt Road Initiative as a brand? And moreover, in the case of SCO, where again, you know, this issue is part of the development strategy, where Pakistan is a member, so to an extent even CPEC also might figure in that. So given that, what really would be our strategy when we actually, let's say, work in these organizations? Thank you.
As far as our equity in AIIB is concerned, it's just about 8% or now. Around that, the largest equity is Chinese, of course. We are there, but we are not in a position to decisively influence every decision. As far as the SCO is concerned, it is a, we know it that how, with this balkanization of Soviet Union, Central Asian Republic, China, and basically it was a Chinese initiative with the collaboration of Russia to keep the Central Asian Republic in the fold, not to get away in the Western fold. We are member, we have been observer for quite some time, now we are even a member. These forums, first and foremost, we don't discuss bilateral issues as such, but this gives you a diplomatic outreach, at least to a part of the deliberations, and when you are part of a deliberation, you are also to some extent, varying degree, able to influence it. To that extent, we are, I mean, and in varying degrees linkages, we are part of a larger family. Whether the IIB or the LHS, the Optics Bank, Development Bank, or the LHS SC. Now, when it comes to these projects which China is undertaking in our neighborhood, which is likely to impact on our security, we can do certain things and which we are contemplating, we are, and the government is working on it, is essentially how to ensure that the threat, right now we do not have any military threat as such, but you know that these are all mostly dual use. Wherever there is a commerce, there is a military element to it also, it will necessarily follow, it is followed. Take the case of Indian Ocean region. As of today, there are 12 naval ships in the Indian Ocean region. At any point of time, they have a couple of ships, whether it's either doing submersible, either the submarine or over the surface, or maybe some research mapping, hydrological survey, and all those things. They are quite actively operating in the Indian Ocean region. Wherever we see the threat, we can work to counter that. Now that we have a number of assets. Our greatest asset is our island chain. The entire sea lane of communication goes through your Andaman, Nicobar, chain of islands. They are unsinkable aircraft carriers. Any advantage which your adversary chooses to take at any place, you have the vulnerability. Similarly, to a lesser degree, but important is on our western flank, the Arabian Sea, when we have this luxury pilots. We have not looked at this for a very long time as a strategic asset. Now we are thinking on this, is very much under thought. So there are many ways by which, it's not that the game is up, it is not far from it. And it's not just chess meeting. We have the requisite assets, inherent advantages. We need to cash in on that. And I think right now the orientation is on that line.
Okay, we've got 10 minutes, and there are many people who are wanting to raise their hands and give me surprise looks. Please bear with me. Yeah, yourself. I'll come to you. Last three questions, M, number two, and last prayer now. Sorry, we can't entertain. You all get delayed.
Good evening, sir. A fabulous exposition, but that was what was expected from you, sir. So I have two observations which I would like to add to what sir has said. One is regarding the creation of virtual client states by China in its neighborhood. And the second aspect pertains to the future of the Chinese economy. In that, we are moving on to high-end, high-value manufacturing with very low labor costs. The first one, of course, is very obvious, what Sir has actually brought out, that by pushing low-end manufacturing into these countries, like in the case of Indonesia, they were importing aluminium from them raw. Now they have set up a factory over there, and they are taking about 95% refined aluminium from them. And that's also created a dependence. So many of these states, I think Pakistan, they're going to push a huge amount of low-end manufacturing, as also avoid the pollution that has been caused over there to Pakistan and places like that. The other issue is regarding the future of the Chinese economy. So today, you would notice China is the largest buyer of robotics in the world. And it is also investing very heavily into artificial intelligence. In fact, just yesterday, was the statement by the US intelligence community about the Chinese investment in artificial intelligence company, and they are really buying into them. And they are looking at reducing the labor cost in view of the aging demography and also labor costs rising up by inducting robotics at every place. Instead of paying three shift labors with, you know, all the other things. They are planning to go in for this, and they're trying to make the jump like what Japan did by virtually bypassing one rule. So the Internet of Things, the Internet of Everything, along with manufacturing robotics, I think perhaps is what they're looking at. So one assessment is that the Chinese economy is going to remain very competitive in the days to come, sir.
Thank you, Kuldeep. You are absolutely right. He's a brilliant analyst. You know what? China's investment, ODI, as they call outward direct investment, in Europe and in Southeast Asia are qualitatively different. You mentioned Indonesia. In Southeast Asia, their maximum investment is in Indonesia. There they are in, basically, you know, infrastructure, transport sector. And they are not very greatly enthusiastic about these areas, though they would like to increase their leverage. When it comes to Europe, it's innovation technology. You mentioned about robotics. Look, they have taken over German KUKA, which is automation. It's the age of automation. You know, they are very quick at realizing the fact that the future is, future belongs to the one who has edge over technology, technological edge over other countries. That's what, even if you look at the third offset which US has, is that when they see that the other countries are trying to compete and match or reduce the US advantage, military advantage over the others, they are going with the third option, going massive way, automation. Under the surface, on the surface, above the sky, everywhere. So China is going in a big way in automation, new technology, innovation. They are acquiring. You know, there's a Finnish company which is there in video game. Now, video game is very interesting. It's a very huge company. But look at the people, those who play the game. First thing is, you influence, you see how people are engaged, you kind of the game that you create. And there's a huge market for that. There's a lot of scope for innovation into that. The British company, which is a big data analytics, they know that the future belongs to the one who has the big data analytics with it. They're virtually buying over that British company. So, yes, you're right, the Chinese economy is going to be competitive. But the fact is that they also have to undergo a lot of reforms because, after all, having got used to certain growth, when that comes down, it creates its own pain. And adjusting to that pain will not be just over simply by calling it as a new normal. They have to ensure that the pain is reduced.
Okay. Last two questions, please be very brief.
Thank you very much, Mr. My name is Goyal. I'm a retired Forest Service officer. My two passmates have already asked the questions. Ambassador Srivastava and Ambassador Sajjanha, and I agree with most of what they said. However, what I wanted to say is that I really appreciate the presentation that you have made today because we have been able to reduce the entire project of BRI into those simplistic elements which become easy for us to understand. That's a great compliment because it's important to understand what it's all about. And I completely agree that it is really about the growth story of China, growth in all sectors. My comment basically is that yes, we must actually respond to this project or this initiative strategy of China, not by basically waiting for it to fall by the wayside, but by doing something which can actually give advantage to India. And in that sense, what you said about building connectivity project, I agree. Building projects in the neighboring countries, I completely agree. Where I fail to really go is how do we do these things? If you look at the story of the development partnership with the neighboring countries, It's a string of failure. Not the failure because of conception, but failure because we have not been able to provide enough resources. Even after 20, 30 years, there is a huge resource asymmetry between India and China. Unless we are able to put our money where our mouth is, I don't think we can work on it. And that's the biggest problem.
No, I agree with you. That has been the case, as other learned participant came out with the point that yes, we have a credibility deficit. We don't deliver in time. I mean, on time. We have perhaps not keeping the promises. No, as far as the resource is concerned, yes, there's no question of China has a far deeper pocket than we have. That's okay. But India, perhaps what it can do alone, it can do. What it can do with the partnership, it should do. We all know that how one of the country which is willing to be, which is a willing partner is Japan. They have. Though they have not talked so much about it then because they are not in the advertising game. Their partnership for quality infrastructure, what they call it, they have $150 billion they have allocated. And it's not just a fiction, they have allocated. So now we need to see that this is put used to together along with Japan, wherever it serves our purpose. So I agree with you that we have to put the money where it should be. Resource, we cannot compete with China, but with the neighboring countries, especially with respect to the neighboring countries, the question is some of the projects, some of the big ticket projects which these countries have got into are actually not the priority projects for those countries. Now, can we do something to help them? Together and the pain of it is going to they are going to face. Well, a strategic cost of Chinese investment is something which is not being taken note of by many people, because in the whole noise of Belt Road Initiative, the countries are going through the pain of it. Maybe because the countries, the system of governance, the institutions are poor, transparency is not there, corruption is rampant, there are many factors behind that. But the fact is that their countries are going through the pain of it. Now, if a strategic cost, then we tell all these countries to people, those who are going into it, that look, do you really need it? These are the cost of it. This is where your experience of the neighbors. Is it your sort of priority so that you are able to take a conscious decision? If they choose to go sort of despite that, well, it's okay, but certainly we can help them in a fair clinical audit of Chinese projects the way they are doing. And the rest, of course, I agree with you that we need to have the credibility.
Okay, last question of the day, Prerna.
Sir, I'm Prerna Gandhi, I'm a researcher at VIF. I have two comments. One is, actually shows the negative side of award for us, and one is the positive side for us. Now in the negative side, we have to understand one thing, that it is not the AIIB or even the Maritime Silk Road Fund that is funding Belt and Road. Apparently in a study by PricewaterhouseCoopers, it said that 500 billion worth of projects have either been executed, planned as of 2017. Mostly, like the media misses it out that it's the Chinese policy banks that are funding it. And if you look at it, the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, its total financial capitalization is $100 billion, whereas the Exim Bank of China lends $80 billion in a year. So it's something that we definitely cannot compete with. Now, on the positive side, apparently with so much of history that has built up, you can't say history, but so much of timeline that has built up with BRI, countries around the world are realizing that most of the Chinese projects are potential debt traps. And that is something that needs to be publicized, that the Chinese are taking up projects that may not fit into the infrastructure ecosystem of those countries. Maybe they do not need it. China is pushing its agenda, but the countries have to, you know, realize that debt trap is there. See, these countries are undergoing this experience. Probably you have an equal chance of undergoing it. And on the other side also, if we look at it, the US has decided to revive the Indo-Pacific Economic Corridor. Apparently, if the Indian interests and the US interests can be connected with this, that we are going to the Asia-Africa Growth Corridor, and US is reviving the Indo-Pacific Economic Corridor. So it leads from a whole belt from Africa, South Asia to Southeast Asia. So it could be something beneficial for us in the future. It's not the Chinese are going to reign supreme. They have a lot of potential problems also. Thank you.
Thank you, Prerna. You know, we have to be very clinical in our approach. Whether a project serves our interest, whatever be the noise around it, we have to see it, clearing the smoke, and see how it is. We must have the ability. Anyway, as a researcher, I'm sure you'll be doing that, and we expect, because much of the papers that we see, what comes out, is building around the noise. Looking clinical into the issue, we don't see many papers. Which goes, I have yet to see a project, at least I have not read it, the strategic cost of CPEC for China. We all know that 46 billion, how many billion actually gone into it? You mentioned about PricewaterhouseCoopers saying that 500 billion. I really wonder whether even 20% of it has really been invested. Now, they have said about 46 billion has started with CPEC. How much is the actual money which has come? Not even 10. So, they make an announcement like a stun gun. I'm a stun grenade. They dazzle you with the light and dazzle you with the sound. We need to strip ourselves of all this, strip it, and then we need to look at it. That's what we said, that yes, our position is BRI as a brand is not, we are not comfortable, we don't accept it. Individual product. If product is good, why not? We will go for it. But simply because it belongs to a particular brand, I have to go through it? No. If a cream hurts my skin, I don't have to buy it. It might be a big brand, let it be. Yes, it be. Thank you very much.
Speaker, I think it was a very absorbing talk he gave, and the number of questions which have been asked obviously indicate the kind of interest which everybody has in this particular subject. A few words I'd like to say. Chinese have a dream. They have a dream, and it's not that they can realize it in very short time. They, for the preparation of their own armed forces, they gave a time frame of about 20 years. And that's how they plan, and that's how they work. And their annual budget is around $160 to $200 billion, anywhere in between. So take it around $180 billion. So they are spending money on it. And they are producing most of their equipment themselves. So they naturally get it at a for themselves at a very cheap rate. Pakistan is a tool, state, client, whatever you may like to call it, but they are a tool for them, actual tool for them. Through them, they are getting a presence in the Indian Ocean. And they are building up, like the speaker said also, they are building up ports all around India. And with their presence in the Indian Ocean, and that is, all this is happening when America has gone into an inward looking mode. So which is perhaps brings them a lot of responsibility on the shoulders of India, whether we like it or not. And are we preparing for it? That's a question. That's a question which we need to answer. Can we really prepare for it when we have a budget below 2%? And with our kind of a GDP, it is just hovering around $2 trillion. So that is a question which we need to answer for ourselves. But yes, we have Chinese on our in our neighborhood, a clash with them. Always a possibility because our interests clash. They cannot be a big part till the time India is standing next to them shoulder to shoulder. So they got to really bring you at a stage where you are really not a country which can compete with them. But I'm sure with the time we'll also take care of things perhaps much faster pace than we are doing today. So with that, once again, I have no words to express our gratitude to Mr. Anand Ravi. Delivered an excellent talk, and also his answers to all the questions were very, very precise and with a lot of depth in them. So once again, a warm round of applause.
India-China.
Certainly.
He's an expert.